In the chilling winter of 1942, Einar Skinnarland, a seemingly ordinary worker from the Vemork plant in Norway, held a secret that could change the course of World War II. The Vemork plant was the sole producer of a mysterious substance called heavy water, a key ingredient the Nazis desperately needed for their nuclear ambitions. The stakes were unimaginably high. If the Third Reich got their hands on enough heavy water, they could potentially unleash the devastating power of the atom. It would be up to Skinnarland to guide a team of Allied commandos on a top-secret demolition mission to blow up Vemork and stop the Nazi atomic bomb. This most daring of endeavors, dubbed Operation Freshman, would require elite engineers, specially modified Handley Page Halifax bombers, and untested gliders. It would end with Hitler's infamous commando order, casting a shadow over the entire war. In 1935, Irene Curie, the eldest daughter of Pierre and Marie Curie, was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry, together with her husband Frédéric Joliot, for her incredible discovery, induced radioactivity. Unknowingly, they had unleashed a chain reaction that would forever change the world. By April 1939, the couple published an article in the scientific journal Nature explaining how their findings could lead to immense power generation. They predicted that atomic fission was indeed possible. Unsurprisingly, the German government did not take long to get intrigued by the idea, and more precisely, its unlimited potential to create the ultimate weapon, and they got to work. As time passed, the scientists working on the project progressed. By September 1941, they had figured out how to create a nuclear reactor. To make this happen, they needed heavy water, a special form of water with deuterium, a heavier form of hydrogen atoms. The liquid acted as a neutron moderator, encasing the uranium that would serve as the material for the nuclear weapon. However, heavy water was extremely scarce and challenging to produce. Germany only had a small amount of it, which had been made in laboratories. To support their ambitious pursuits, the German government set out to obtain enough heavy water for their atomic weapons program, as the entire world entered one of its most grim periods. In the once peaceful village of Rjukan in Norway, there was a chemical plant called Vemork Norsk Hydro, a plant with a huge supply of heavy water. Curiosity arose when the German government suddenly showed an increased interest in purchasing heavy water from Norway. Cautious and suspicious of this demand, the Norwegian government decided to limit its sale, allowing only 3 gallons per month to be sold. Unfortunately, their suspicions became a reality. In April 1940, Germany invaded Norway and occupied the country. With Norway under German control, the situation changed drastically. The Vemork plant was taken over, and its production of heavy water was redirected to support the German atomic weapons program. Initially, the production faced challenges due to the impact of the fighting in Norway and the drought in the region. The lack of water hindered the production process, as the plant relied on hydroelectric power. However, as the weather improved and the snow started melting, the availability of water increased, enabling the plant to generate enough hydroelectric power to resume heavy water production and fuel the Nazis' atomic weapon program without restriction. In fact, shortly after the occupation, the Vemork plant was ordered to triple their production of the valuable liquid in less than 2 years. In the middle of 1942, the British government learned troubling news. Not only did the plant produce significant amounts of heavy water, but the Germans were suspiciously hoarding it for later use. Realizing this threat, they decided that the plant and its heavy water stockpiles had to be destroyed to hinder German efforts. Various options were explored for the destruction mission. One idea was to launch a massive raid with Royal Air Force bombers. However, this plan was dismissed due to the challenges of locating the plant during night bombing, the primary tactic used by the RAF at the time, and the potentially heavy civilian casualties that a night raid would inflict on the local Norwegian population. Another option considered was an attack by Norwegian saboteurs. Still, this approach was ruled out as well. Likewise, the idea of landing troops via PBY Catalina flying boats on Lake Masvatn, approximately 15 miles away from the target, was abandoned due to the steep slopes of the surrounding mountains and the inability of flying boats to land on the icy surface of the lake. After careful deliberation, it was determined that a raid, carried out by glider-borne airborne troops, presented the best chance of success. Although the terrain around the plant would be challenging for landing, a potential landing site for gliders was identified near the Mosvatn Dam. Nevertheless, executing a safe landing there would require exceptional skill from the glider pilots. With the plan in place, preparations for the daring raid began. The British enlisted Einar Skinnarland, a skilled Norwegian engineer working at the Mosvatn Dam, who had bravely sailed to Britain. After intense training for 10 days, he was parachuted back to his homeland, Telemark County. Skinnarland had valuable contacts within Vemork and gathered important information about the German troops and defenses in the area. In the rugged mountains of Norway, the RAF faced immense challenges. Skinnerland's return marked only the second time they managed an operation for the special forces in that region. With unpredictable weather and tricky terrain, it wasn't an easy task. Skinnerland had crucial intelligence, but there was a problem. The summer nights were short, leaving little time for cover. So, based on his information, they had to wait until the autumn of 1942 to make a move. In the meantime, Skinnerland became friends with the chief engineer of the plant. He used this friendship to gather more important details needed for a special mission and relayed all this vital information to the Special Operations Executive, or SOE, in London using a radio. In addition to Skinnerland, the SOE decided to send a group of Norwegian agents as part of Operation Grouse. The four-man team, led by Jens Anton Poulsen and consisting of Knut Haugland, Klaus Hellberg, and Arne Kjellstrup, were locals with exceptional outdoor skills. They underwent rigorous training in Scotland to learn sabotage, radio transmitting, and other skills needed to operate in occupied territory. After months of preparation, the Grouse team was ready to be inserted into Telemark in October. However, bad weather caused several flight attempts to be aborted. Finally, on October 18th, the team was dropped at Fjarafet on the Hardangervidda, a vast wilderness avoided by the German forces. They spent the next 15 days trekking towards Mosvatn, where they established contact with London. The British then asked a secret question, quote, "What did you see in the early morning?" To which the infiltrators responded, quote, "Three pink elephants." They had succeeded. The heavy water plant was nestled high above a river on a rocky shelf, 1,000 feet up, in challenging terrain, unsuitable for parachutists or gliders. However, a daring plan was hatched. A glider-borne landing would be attempted on a landing zone 5 hours away on foot. The brave team of raiders, comprising 12 to 16 skilled engineers, was carefully chosen for this hazardous mission. They were handpicked from volunteer parachutists, the 9th Field Company and 261st Field Company RE, led by Lieutenants A.C. Allen and D.A. Methven. To reach their target safely, the raiders would rely on a Rebecca Eureka radio location device, guiding them to the landing zone. From there, they would be guided by Norwegian locals to their ultimate objective, the destruction of the heavy water plant. Under cover of darkness, the group departed, towed by two brave Halifaxes from the 38th Wing of the RAF. The weather conditions were not favorable, but these determined pilots and their gliders pressed on. Only one of the aircraft made it back safely to base, leaving the fate of the others unknown until the war's end. The first glider group managed to reach their intended landing site, but fate dealt them a cruel hand. Ice formed on the tow rope, causing it to break prematurely, and the glider crashed into the unforgiving mountainside. Tragically, 8 of the 17 men inside lost their lives, while 9 were captured by the enemy, and 4 of them were injured. In an act of cruelty, 5 captives were shot, and the injured were poisoned by a German doctor on Gestapo orders. The second tug glider group faced a similar fate, crash landing near Helgoland. The aircraft crew and 3 of the glider team lost their lives, and the survivors were eliminated after being captured under Hitler's controversial commando order. Operation Freshman had failed, and now the Germans were aware of the Allied interest in their heavy water production. After the failure of Operation Freshman, Britain's SOE faced a serious setback. 41 British commandos were lost, and the Nazis expected an attack on their sole source of heavy water. Thus, the SOE decided that the best chance of success lay in Operation Gunnerside, which involved handpicking a squad of operatives from Kompani Linga, a group of SOE-trained Norwegian patriots led by Captain Martin Linga. Lieutenant Joachim Runeberg was chosen to lead the mission and carefully selected five men for the task. They underwent thorough training, including studying a scale model replica of the Vemork plant. On the night of February 16, 1943, the Gunnerside team parachuted into Norway, but faced delays due to a snowstorm. It took a week to rendezvous with local resistance leader Poulsen and his companions, now codenamed Swallow, who had survived on the mountain throughout the winter and sabotaged the plant without losing any Norwegian lives. Likewise, they had been conducting reconnaissance of the power plant's defenses. The Germans had fortified the area after the freshman mission, but Swallow discovered a way to safely descend a steep ravine, cross a frozen river, and reach the plant via an unguarded railway line. On February 28th, the teams crossed the ravine just before midnight when the guards changed shifts. Runeberg and the sabotage team snuck into the plant unnoticed. They found where the heavy water was processed and stored, surprising a Norwegian night watchman. Runeberg and explosives expert Birger Stromsheim planted charges with a 30-second fuse. After leaving the room, Runeberg ignited the fuse. The explosion was muffled, and the guards initially attributed it to the plant's combustion equipment. The mission was a success, and all team members escaped. While the plant was only slightly damaged, over 1,000 pounds of heavy water and equipment necessary for its production were destroyed. Subsequent bombing raids further damaged the facility. After the successful operation, two members of the SOE team stayed behind to train and arm volunteers for the Norwegian Home Army, the resistance movement. Knut Haukelid and Skinnarland established a base on a farm to gather information for SOE headquarters in London. In July, they received information that production had restarted at the Vemork plant. An attempt was made to destroy the plant using a United States Army Air Force bombing raid, which damaged the factory but left the heavy water plant intact due to its protected location. Then the Germans took a desperate measure: dismantle and ship the entire plant to Germany. Ultimately, Operation Gunnerside's success significantly hampered Germany's nuclear ambitions during World War II. In January 1944, Haukelid and Skinnarland took risks by gathering information about the planned shipment in local towns. They found out that the heavy water plant would be transported on a Norwegian ferry boat across Lake Tinsio. Haukelid placed charges on the keel of the ferry, causing it to sink in Lake Tinsio in February 1944. Unfortunately, several Norwegian lives were lost in the process. Despite the setback, Skinnarland maintained radio contact between the local Norwegian resistance and SOE headquarters in London until the end of World War II in Europe. At that point, the Norwegian Home Army took over the administration of their country. Operation Gunnerside was considered the SOE's greatest mission, and all team members were decorated. Extensive media coverage followed the Vemork missions, including a Norwegian film in 1948 and a fictionalized version in the 1965 film The Heroes of Telemark.